Hey guys, welcome back to Let's Play Xanadu for the MSX. A little bit of a bonus episode in which I can show you a couple of the items I've been picking up, and as I promised before, I'll give you a little look at how karma works. So right now we have zero karma, which is good. Again, karma is the last of the light blue statistics, so under agility, the KRM 000 says we currently do not have any karma built up, and again you want to keep your karma at zero if at all possible. Now I'll show you one way to mess that up, and that is by going down here. You can find these little guys called Weenals, the little ghost guys that you saw on the bottom of my screen just now, and they are considered good by the game, which means that you're not allowed to kill them. They'll shoot you with magic attacks, but they won't actually damage you, which is one of the hints that that this guy isn't actually an evil monster. And they die very, very easily. Just touching them will usually kill them almost right away, even if you don't have like high-level items that I have. And as you can see, they give only 10 experience, which is very strange for a level 3 monster. If I look at my statistics now, my karma immediately shot up to 6. So each of killing one of these guys will get you 6 karma. And of course, killing a lot of them, as I'm doing right now, will get you even more karma. Let me just kill them with my axe to see if we can figure out what kind of items they drop. See if it's ever worth killing these guys. Demon's ring, okay, so definitely not worth it. And my karma just from killing that one group shot up to 48. Now 48 is obviously, I don't know, because you don't know what it's used for, but 48 is a lot of karma for just one fight. You know what, let me do a little experiment and see if the consecutive spawns of this guy, if they all give you karma or just the first one. Let me just get this guy out of the way, because there's two of them down here, of course. One of them should be respawned around here somewhere. There he is. So I'll kill these guys too and see if my karma goes up any further. I think so. I think all of their spawns are karma inducing. Yep, another 50, 60, yeah, something like that, karma added. And kill one more, here we go. Oh, I was going to use my sword, wasn't I? To see what kind of items they drop. Actually, I don't need to pick up the boxes, we're not going to continue this anyway. Because this must... If you let your karma go up over 100, you're pretty much screwed. There's no way to get it back down. Because... oh, brown potion, I guess that's okay. It's not really worth getting any karma for, though. Because we talked about this earlier. Karma is only removed by drinking poison. And poison can only be found in towers and by killing certain types of monsters. And the only... let's see, 138, 144, yep, they all give you 6 karma. And the only way to get rid of it is by drinking poison, and each poison bottle reduces your karma by 5. So just killing one of these guys means you have to drink 2 poison bottles before you get back to normal. And it's pretty much impossible to find 20 poison bottles in the first level or so. So, in the first couple of levels. So... Basically, if you let your karma go up the way I am right now, your entire game is pretty much over. You have to restart. It's one of the nice things about the 8-bit era is that games could just really screw you over like this, and you could be playing for a couple of weeks and then you'd build up some karma without noticing that you killed a good monster, and you're just gonna have to go back to level 1, because that's it. It's game over. I'll show you the effect right now. Again, we talked about this earlier, what it does is it makes it so that you cannot level up anymore. And it does so by barring you from any temple or the king's castle. If you have even one karma point, they simply won't let you in and you will never be able to level up again. So if you have more karma than you have poison left, you're boned. The game is just over. Get out of the way, Grimlock. I want to find a temple. There's one. So if we go into a temple now, it's closed. There's no way we can get back in there. So again, we are now essentially boned because there's no way to level up. There's no way to get into the higher, deeper levels of the dungeon. So yeah, if I didn't have an earlier save game, it would be game over right now. But before we throw in the towel and restart, I wanted to show you one or two more things. And one of them is... Oops, I'm sorry. These are my save games. I just wanted to check I had a backup before I went any further. What was I saying? Oh yeah, some of the items we picked up in level 2 and 3 that are interesting to look at. Okay, spectacles we've seen. Red potion is just a healing potion. Lamp, we know what it does. Then we have a black onyx and a fire crystal. Now these are interesting items because they allow you to get to the next level without actually opening the gates. So right now I couldn't go to level 4 because I don't have the enough experience. But using a black onyx I can actually cheat and go to the next level anyway. So you equip the black onyx like any other item. To activate it you press enter, again like any other item. And I'm now warped into level 4, even though I normally couldn't get here again at this level. See what kind of... Yeah, see, these creatures are a little bit out of my league right now. Despite my having great armor, these guys will really, really hurt. And the items they drop aren't even that impressive. So yeah, we went up to level 4 without actually being allowed to go here yet. That's pretty cool. Now the fire crystal is more or less the same thing, only in reverse. So if we equip a fire crystal, press enter, we are warped back to our previous level, in this case level 3. So those are kind of cool. Now let's see, what else do we have that's interesting? Well, we've seen the Madoc. The mantle makes you transparent temporarily, which lets you walk through walls and doors and that sort of thing. But I think it only works in towers. Then we have the Demon's Ring, which makes you sort of invisible. I honestly have no idea what the purpose of this is because I've never been able to use it effectively for anything. Monsters will still attack you. I don't know, I have no idea what it's good for. Then we have a balance, which temporarily increases your... Oh, no, I'm sorry. The balance actually opens all the on-screen treasure boxes. So if you've killed a bunch of creatures, and you don't want to waste your time opening the boxes one by one, you can use a balance, and it'll just open all of them. Let me show you with this guy. Oops. Oh yeah, the Lizard Monster is actually one of the rare creatures that... resists mitars. Okay, so there's a couple of boxes on screen. I use the balance. And they all open automatically, allowing me to pick them up without wasting any time. So yeah, that's the balance. What else do we have? I think that's most of the interesting ones. Oh yeah, this one's really weird. You have a candle. Again, I have no idea what the purpose of this is. But you can change yourself into a skeleton. It only lasts a little while, but you can walk around as a skeleton, if you like. No idea what use that is. Again, monsters will still attack you and that sort of thing, so... Yeah, I don't really get it. Let's see, pendant opens doors, we talked about that one. Ruby temporarily increases your strength. Ground potion temporarily increases. Intelligence. The mirror is, I think, dexterity or something. Agility, sorry. So that's quite useful. If you're fighting a monster that you're having a hard time hitting, you can just use a mirror and temporarily increase your agility. And of course the bottle, which increases your charisma, which we talked about. in the previous episode. Okay guys, that's our little bonus feature, showcasing some of the items and a little bit more of the game mechanics, and that's all for now. I'll see you in the next part.